Welcome to once again Dr. Rajesh Verma's YouTube channel. In this particular video, the discussion will be on, you know, nature of perception part 2. So as in earlier videos, we have discussed the part 1, that is nature of perception. As it was, if I would have combined the videos in one video, total that total topic in one video, it would be a little longer. Here there are two images. These images clearly depict how we perceive that, as I discussed in a previous video. So both images, one is a natural one, one is a man-made one. If I showed these videos, images to the two different people or more than two people, they will interpret these videos as per their belief system, their cultural settings, their immediate mental setup, and various other factors that influence this their perception. So in this process, now let us start the nature of perception part 2. That is very helpful for your the graduate level examination. At the outset, we'll start with the characteristics of perception, as the meaning and definition I already discussed in my previous video. So we'll starting with the characteristics of perception. The first characteristics one, as this animation is showing you, it is the function of psychological and physical states of the perceiver. That means to say, at the moment when we receive a stimulus, that may be from your different stimulus, can be different shape, size, color, sound, or function or activity. But the moment we receive it, at that particular moment, what is the psychological and physical state of individual? That states significantly influence the perception. Suppose you are in a good mood and you your tire of your two wheeler or four wheeler deflated. At that moment, as you are in a good mood and your tire gets deflated, at that moment you will think that need not to worry about it. Let us use our pump, or you can change the stepney of your four wheeler or two wheeler. That is, in that case, you don't need to be worried, because your perception of that situation has been influenced by your psychological state. In other, for example, in physical state, if you are sleeping and feeling so bit tired and feeling sleepy, and in fact you are sleeping, and there is a song which you like most is run on some some function or some television or some radio or mobile phone. At that state, you don't like to listen that song. You'd only like to sleep, although that song is of very much interest to you. So dear friends, this way the perception is influenced by the psychological as well as the physical state of the perceiver. Okay, next important characteristic of perception is, it is selective process. That means picking up what we want. I told you several times, so perception, in perception, we do not perceive the things as they are. We perceive the things as we love to perceive. So it is a selective process. For example, when you go to school and for fetching your child, you see all small babies, all small children, they are looking very beautiful in their similar uniform. But you don't worry about that. You just focus on your what, and all from in more than 100 meters, you select from the pool of these babies your own child. This means you are not perceiving all child at once. Their movement, their uniform, their different emotional expressions on their face, their physical activity. We don't perceive that. What we perceive is we only focus on our own child, where he or she is. We try to locate him or her. This means it is a selective process, picking up what we want. And the next, our characteristic of perception is, it is subjective as well as objective process. I told you, how it is subjective? Subjective means when more than two individuals perceive the same stimulus in different way. Whereas objective process means when the more than two individuals perceive the same stimulus in same way. You are told it's a subjective process. If you are going to a restaurant and you order for a meal, in that various they provide various curries, various vegetables, various other objects you order for. When you receive a bowl of dal makhani, and you are 4 or 5 members of your family members or your friends, each family member will taste or your friend taste that dal makhani, and in that case you ask them, everyone will define the taste of that dal makhani as a different way. But where is the stimulus? Is the same. So I told you, it's a subjective process. In this sense, it is a subjective process. You call in other way around, if you go to how it is objective process, if there is a bus is moving or truck or two wheeler, a car is moving on the road, if you ask two people, can you name the object that is moving the road? Everyone will tell you that it's a bus, it's a truck, or it's a car. So in this sense, your perception is objective process. So it's very interesting to know that your perception is subjective as well as objective. The next characteristics of perception is it represents the needs, desires, and wants of an individual. When you perceive something, we try to perceive as it is, but that our perception is influenced by various our psychological constructs, concepts, and various cognition. How it is? Your needs, what you like most, what are your desires, and what you want. All these things influence the perception. Suppose if you look for the purchase of a you get a four wheeler or a car, you go to the car showroom. There, when you perceive the vehicle, you do not perceive the vehicle as it is. You try to compare that vehicle in context or with your needs, your desires, what you want. You want the beautiful design, you want the color, or you want the interiors, you want the speed, pickup, all these things. Means you want to perceive that object in context of these your psychological concepts, that is your needs, desires, and wants. Understand? The next part is, that is next characteristic of perception is, it helps. It means the perception helps in understanding the human behavior. Means you can comprehend or understand the behavior of other individual through how and what that individual perceives, or how that individual perceives the things. So this is a very important characteristics. It's a contextual, simultaneous, and interactive process. Means when we perceive something, we perceive in context of something else. It is simultaneous process. Means when we are perceiving some object or stimulus, it's not that we are totally engaged in perceiving that, or that perception is a function of only one sense organ. See, when you see something, well, that information travels to your brain. In your brain, your neurons, your various specific parts of your brain, they interact together, they act together, and simultaneously they function and finally comes out with a product, and we call it as a perception. Okay, it's a contextual, simultaneous, and interactive process. And next characteristics, perception is highly individualistic process. Means in other words, if you like to define perception, is it is subjective process. Means when we are perceiving something, that information is processing in your brain. I cannot perceive what is perceiving right now in your brain, nor you can perceive, nor you can know what is occurring inside my brain. Because only I am knowing, only I am aware of that, because it's an individualistic process. What I'm perceiving of an object is, you cannot perceive that object in the same fashion, because it is an individualistic process. You cannot know what I'm perceiving, how I'm perceiving. No one can know. Neither I can know how you are perceiving this video. So that's why it is known as highly individualistic process. It is an aggregate conscious process. How it is? Means it is the word aggregate conscious process means we can perceive the object only when we are conscious about that. If you are not conscious about that, suppose someone is, take a simple example of fully ingrained in watching a movie of his very much liking. At that moment, your mother calls you. You won't listen then. It is not that you are not listening deliberately, but you are not perceiving, because your consciousness, your awareness is focused or fixed at a particular point. So your ears are receiving that sound, call of your mother, and transferring your ears, receptors are transferring that sound into your neural impulses, and neural impulses through auditory nerve traveling to your brain. But brain is not processing that information. Sensing is taking place, but perception is not. That's why you need to be conscious to perceive something. Where is aggregate? Aggregate means when you perceive something, suppose you are seeing something or hearing something, you do not perceive that object in parts, in components. We perceive that object as a whole, and the total outcome of that object, that is aggregate. Getting my point? So perception is aggregate conscious process. And the next characteristics is, it can be realistic as well as unrealistic. How it is? Suppose we perceive the things as which we look at, or which we hear at, which we taste or touch or smell at. Okay? So as they are, suppose I am perceiving water as water, it's realistic. But when we are perceiving the taste of water, or taste of the tea, taste of the coffee, that is, you call it as a subjective individualistic process, and it's unrealistic. If someone asks you, can you show me the taste of the tea? We cannot, because it is unrealistic. Getting my point? So perception is realistic as well as unrealistic. So the last characteristics of perception is, it is relative, that is contextual, and multimodal process, that depends upon simultaneous activation of senses. I told you earlier, it's a little bit different, that the multimodal process means you cannot perceive, or the process cannot occur in single mode. It has to be, your various sense organ has to be activated, and they has to be activated simultaneously. Your brain has to activate, your neurons has to activate. All this process involves in the perception is known as multimodal process, and dear friends, it's a relative one. It's not pure. So perception is relative and multimodal. That depends upon simultaneous activation of your sense organs. So these are the 10 important characteristics of perception. There are two approaches, important approaches, or we call it these as process approaches in the perception. So these are, you know, first one is top-down processing, and the second one is your bottom-up processing. So what is top-down processing? Top-down processing means the idea, that recognition process or sensory process, means sensation, there's a part of sensory process, begins from the whole, which leads to identification of its various components. So dear friends, there's a fundamental difference between top-down processing and bottom-up processing. Top-down processing says that when we perceive an object or a stimulus, we perceive that object as a whole at the outset. After that, we perceive the and identify the various components of that stimulus. For example, when you are visiting a party, in that case, when you are so much hungry, suppose you are feeling lots of hungry, in that case, what you do is, initially the perception of the food will be top-down processing. You just move, pick up the plate, just pour something in your plate and start eating. After some part of the food has traveled to your stomach, entered in your stomach, when you are little bit of satiated, not fully satiated, in that, after that, you start commenting on the type of foods, taste of the food, the spices, spiciness or non-spiciness of the food. So means initially, that is a simple, a crude example of a difference between top-down and bottom-up processing. Means there are two approaches. One approach says, top-down processing says, the recognition part, the process, that is a part of sensory process, it begins with through whole of the object. After that, that leads to identification of various components. That is simple. If you look at a four-wheeler or a two-wheeler, suppose you are looking at a very important, very attractive bike. Top-down processing says, first you look at the bike as a whole. It's a bike. After that, you start identifying its various components, various design of the components or various items which are fitted in that are making it so attractive. So this is top-down processing. In contrast, just opposite to top-down processing, it is bottom-up processing. What this means? The idea or thought that recognition process begins from the parts which serve as the basis for the identification of whole. What means here? Take the same example of the bike. If you look at the bike, this bottom-up processing says, first we look at the parts, components of the bike. So it's a very beautiful seat, is very beautiful. The stands, the footrest, the engine, the carburetor, the design, that first we look at, perceive the parts, and after that we perceive it as a whole. So this is the explanation by the bottom up processing. So dear friends, the process approach in perception is of contains two parts, the top down processing and bottom-up processing. I think you could get my point. And dear friends, here, Nature of Perception, Part 2. These are my references. You can cross-check them and you can, if you want to study more, you can check them. Apart from these references also, there are lots of books and sites where you can refer for your deeper study of the perception. The next video, as you know, will be starting with perception of form, figure and ground. Understand? This will be our next video, and thank you for watching this video. We'll be meeting you soon with the next video. If you love it, like it, share with others. If you dislike it, you want to say something to me, you can write in my comment box, or you can directly email to me on my email varmasujit@yahoo.com. Till the time, video, those friends, thanks for watching this video.